Good day. I'm very happy that today we are having a possibility to have a conversation regarding historic issues in the European Union. And I'm glad that you, Mr. Belder, you had the opportunity to share your views on our common experience and not common experience in the European Union. Now we are the same big family, but we used to be divided, and I'm very interested. What do you think? What was the input of this division for our current life? Because today, this week, we are commemorating the mass deportation from Lithuania to Siberia, when 40,000 people were deported, and among them 11,000 children. So, how much people in Netherlands and in the European Union know about those events that took place in 1948 and the whole this period under Soviet occupation of three Baltic states and partly, you know, half of Europe?
Firstly, as an historian, I should say I personally, and as an historian, but in general speaking, we know not enough about your history, the history of your country, Lithuania. When I was a teacher of history, I vividly remember that I was attracted to very interesting articles about the fate of your country gaining independence just after the First World War, and then after some decades occupation again in 1940 by the Soviet Union, Stalin Soviet Union, then the Nazi interlude, also a brutal period, and then again an occupation. So when my country, the Netherlands, was liberated after 5 years of occupation, we were liberated, but you were again occupied. And I told that my students in secondary school in Rotterdam in the Netherlands, for then already, and now I'm speaking about the 60s, the 70s, I thought it was very important for them to have a knowledge not only of about Western Europe, but also Central and Eastern Europe. And I must then underline that I was always interested in Central and Eastern Europe under communist rule. So I decided to specialize in Central and East European history at the University of Utrecht. And my teacher was a professor from Czechoslovakia. He was himself in exile from 1948. So, he wrote a book with a good title, The Delayed Liberation. The Delayed Liberation, for you were liberated only with the dissolution of the Soviet Empire in the early 90s. Because of our conversation, I again read a very interesting article from a Lithuanian scholar on the first years after the Second World War, what happened. We were free in the Netherlands. I was born in 1946, and the tragedy that hit your country, your people, the very heroic partisan fight against the Soviet occupation. I think now we are in the European Union, and you are, as the Netherlands, a member country. We should, for common understanding, we should know more and more about the national history, also the national history of your country, to recognize the longing for freedom, your fears about your geopolitical position, for example. Although the Iron Curtain has fallen down, I become more and more convinced that we should know more and more about the history of the member states from Central and Eastern Europe, especially the Baltic states, that has such a vulnerable position, geopolitical position, with regards to re-emerging Russia under Putin.
Yeah, I think I totally agree with you that, you know, those historic experiences, they, in a way, how shall I say, continuous in different angles, but still in nowadays as well, you know, because knowing what kind of neighbors we have and, you know, knowing that not that much has changed in mentality, I mean, at the political level. So for us, it's very important that more and more people in European Union would know what was happening, you know, for 50 years under Soviet occupation. But I would like to go back to your story as you as a teacher. Yes, you said that you were willing to tell, and you were telling for your pupils what was happening in Baltic states and in general in Soviet Union, but there was, in a way, yet still a quite big lack of information. And I assume that, for example, school books, there was nothing written about, you know, Soviet occupation so far. Okay, maybe it was mentioned, but not in details what was happening. So most probably it was purely your how shall I say, your engagement to show for pupils what was happening in Soviet Union. So your knowledge was, as you mentioned yourself, from the university, from the people you met, but did you feel the lack in the school books or in general in public media about the events and things that were happening in Soviet Union?
It was surely given attention. But I must say, there was the danger of the status quo, and that things would not change. Mm-hmm. The era of stagnation under Brezhnev, for example, should be one day without an Iron Curtain. Should be one day that the nations of Central and Eastern Europe could make their own choice, political choice, and it happened. Then I was not more a teacher. I was in the meantime I became a journalist, mm-hmm. so I had the big opportunity to travel to the Baltic states, mm-hmm. in the very emotional and unnerving days of the late 80s, beginning of the 90s, and to speak with people. And but I must say that as a journalist, I use the opportunity to write as much as possible about what was going on. And in the Baltic states, of course, there was they were front runners of the dissolution of the Soviet Union under Gorbachev. And you know, Gorbachev was very unpopular, but what he did for the freedom of the Baltic states, you know, the tragedy that happened then,
yes.
It was a very tumultuous period. So, to understand, the issue is, you lived as your country lived for decades under Soviet occupation. You lived with what was called real socialism. And to have an idea what it was living inside the Soviet Union or under the Soviet influence with myriad regimes, as you write it, you count in the Baltic states and also in the central and the satellite states of Central and Eastern Europe. For me, that was very important. What was life all like? What did it mean for not only in what communism was in theory, but also in practice? For that was important. For you had also in the Netherlands and in the West, of course, left-oriented liberals that play down the ugly faces of real socialism and socialist realism, and say. From time to time, I had the idea that, say, we're satisfied with the status quo. If our freedom, if our liberty was not endangered, so let it be. But when you remembered that how your countrymen longed for and desired for outside help, and how they felt betrayed during the years of resistance, the partisan fight, combat. I read here a Lithuanian historian that said we were already betrayed at Tehran by Roosevelt in 1943, but there was still the hope that the West should come to your
always,
help.
There was always.
Always. And what and what was imp- and that is, I think, a very important lesson for us now in the European Union, that we should never let you again stand alone, fight alone for your liberty and for your freedom. And that, so that inside the European Union, we should very alert to the dangers to the different member states. When we, I'm a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and we always speak about the common foreign and defense policy. Well, and with this Soviet, with this European Union, we should have a close eye, a sharp eye, to the historical plight and the historical events in the Baltic states, in Central Eastern Europe, for they had a delayed liberation. They, I can imagine and I can agree to some level that they feel betrayed by the West. So what we should first learn is what happened to them? What's the influence? For example, you live in Lithuania. I think, as an historian, there are still influences of the Soviet past, of the communist past in your country. Let us have understanding for it. And we, when we are really freedom-loving in Western Europe, we should learn from you what was communism like, what it meant in practice, and to combat all totalitarian ideologies because and systems we had, not I personally, but as an historian, we had the experience of the Nazi past, the Third German Reich. But in my time as a history student, it was it was almost a crime to compare Russia and Soviet Union under Stalin, communism with Nazism with National Socialism. But as a scholar, why could you? Why should you not compare systems? And you had a bitter and tragic experience to have an occupation by both totalitarian regimes. There's a double burden of the past. And both regimes tried to split up your countrymen. For example, during the war for liberation, there were so-called people's defenders that were collaborators. Eh? And we had also our collaborators. So we have things in common, but we have a very different past. And I think you never know enough about another's history, let alone to have an idea about what does it mean for internal life, for society. And therefore, I'm always keen when we speak here about Russia, EU-Russia relations, about the very special and very about the security, national security and national interest of the Baltic states because of the past and also the present, of course. We should not forget, we should not let them alone.
No, I'm really very happy about your thoughts and I appreciate your knowledge and your understanding because it's not that very common here, in the European Parliament. Yes.
Allow me a question. Is it true that you can answer it? Is it true that you have the idea that we here in the European Parliament and in the European Union in general, we have not much knowledge about your tragic past, and therefore we don't take into account when we speak about EU-Russia relations, the special position of and the vulnerable position of your country and the two other Baltic states.
I could relate it to that, lack of knowledge or sort of naivete. That, you know, of course we have to have constructive relations with our old neighbors. But we have to have to take into account the historical experiences, and what I experience here in the European Parliament, but that there are still people who are surprised whenever we talk about you know mass deportations or partisan resistance. Yeah. that they are saying, oh, it was happening, we didn't know that, how come, we want to know more. So in this case, do you think that, okay, we have here this so-called reconciliation of European histories group, and you are a member of it, of this group, as well as me and Ms. Sandra Kalniete and many others. Do you think that our work here in the European Parliament could be more efficient in terms of giving this educational information, providing the educational information for our colleagues, for those who know a bit less? And do you think that it could be our, you know, goal in the European Union to have the common history of EU in the schools, in the school books, you know, not learning one country by the other, but or focusing more on, I don't know, on the national issues, which is very important as well, but, you know, to extend it a little bit more to European Union history as such, I mean, in general, for those who were at the European Union in, I don't know, 1980s, and for those who were not in the European Union at that time, but they are now in it. Because when you mentioned yourself about, you know, Nazis and communist regimes, you know, it's not that much about comparison, comparing the regimes. It's more about evaluating what was happening, just to know it. You know, each suffering is very unique, and we cannot, you know, put some, I don't know, signs of equality or whatever. But to just, you know, to know and to evaluate. So do you think that this educational work, it's the step forward, you know, to the better understanding?
Yes, absolutely. I'm convinced of it. There was always, of course, when I was a teacher, there was a heavy emphasis on the institutions of the European Union, but it was very West European oriented, of course. But I think it should be indeed very stimulating when there is more common knowledge about the diverse history of the peoples and nations that formed together the EU 27. Mm-hmm. And then you can see the similarities, but also the diversities and the specific of the national histories, and that broadened the scope, of course, for school children and students. And I know that they are very interested in looking beyond their own borders, but to give it flesh and bones, the European history. Therefore, I think it should be very good. And also, what do you expect as Baltic states, as Lithuanian citizens from the European Union? What do you expect from it? For you know, there's at the moment it is a difficult period because of the economic crisis, a lot of Euro skepticism, and I'm convinced that we need a European Union for a good cooperation, and to take into account our distinct cultures, languages, histories, for good cooperation. I think to trust a person and to have good cooperation, you should know his background, his interest, and to have an interest by itself. Why I'm an historian? Because I'm interested not simply in people, but in cultures, in the past. Because I'm convinced that that is, everybody has a past. You cannot reject the past. You have ever to confront yourself with the past, and especially in the European Union, when we have when the division was only lifted at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, let alone, that is only some decades ago. So I think we had a lot to do to get more accustomed to and to have more concrete idea what happened after the Second World War, after our liberation, and you still your occupation, and how it still impinges on your culture and on your inner life. But I think how we should cope with it.
This is our, how shall I say, maybe goal or main task in a way, you know, to to work with the people from Western Europe, the colleagues, to share this experience. I have to admit and to confess that me myself, I don't know that much about, for example, history of Portugal. Yeah, and this is again, why they have some concerns regarding one or other issue. Yeah. I mean, so this is our. Obligation in a way, I could say, to know each other better in order to have this common house we are living in, to work properly. And if, the roof leaking in one part of the house, that it sooner or later it can affect the whole house. So when you work together in cooperation, tight cooperation and knowing each other, I think, you can repair all problems and you can solve all problems. So for us it's important to be recognized and to have these reflections from our friends in Europe, that they understand what was happening. For us it's extremely important, because for example I would mention you the simple fact of using the so to say symbols, the forbidden symbols. Okay, we know that swastika is forbidden, and I totally agree. I mean, not raise, emotions and all those things. But there was recently the fact in the European Commission, they had the poster, the hanging poster, with lots of symbols, religious symbols of the religions, and including sickle and a hammer. Of the Soviet, the symbol of the Soviet Union. So it just shows that maybe people don't understand, or they understand and they, willing to put it, consciously. So even these tiny things, it represents and it shows that, we're a bit far away from each other. And when we're talking about, economic crisis and, that we have to work together and we're doing it. But some of those, emotional issues that are very important in our life, still, those examples, they're not very pleasant for us.
It was painful for you. Yes. It was really painful for you. I can totally understand.
These are
very small
examples, but it describes a lot, I assume.
Yeah, so that is not fine-tuning. Then you show that you have no real understanding what it means, such symbols, to people that were under that yoke. And indeed, when we abhor of Nazi symbols, we should also abhor from communist symbols. When you look at, for example, in 1948, you spoke about the May deportation. More than 100,000 farmers, people from the countryside, were deported. Imagine. And I was last year with my wife, I traveled through Lithuania, and it was very beautiful, the landscape. And I was always thinking, what happened here? What happened here during the late 40s? What happened here? And when you look at the reports from the Central Committee, from the Communist Party of the Soviet Union about the so-called bandits that were your freedom fighters. The thousands of lives, and also what is so poisonous? The poison of such system, such regimes as Nazi regime, communist regime, so dictatorships, is that they have always accomplices, collaborators inside the occupied, and that is. That is the more painful for then you had to show up with. We had it also in the Netherlands. Mm. We had also in the Netherlands, and it was a complex picture. So, what I would say is, I'm convinced that there is we had only 5 years of occupation, and this past is still haunting us. The very popular novel at the moment is about a war event in a small village in the west, in the neighborhood of Rotterdam. I was born in the neighborhood. The place is called Rhone, and a lot of students, that there was a teacher, came from Rhone, and there was a tragedy there in the war that is still haunting us. So, let alone what happened in your country. The poison is has the poison really left your countries?
Yes,
and
indeed.
We should, and as as politicians and historians, we should try to depoison and to have knowledge about and to draw the right lessons politically, firstly.
So really, thank you very much, Mr. Bilder, for your thoughts, and really I appreciate your friendship, and hopefully we can work on together for this work, you know, to get know each other much better. Thank
Absolutely.
You very much.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you.